Good evening, Monrovia!
Dry up.
Okay, what happens?
Welcome to Talk TV. How you doing today? Sometimes we get you, the viewers, to participate. If you could only pick up the phone. And you know it's okay. 357-4974. But what I always do first is news flash. For all you folks who just sit at home and never focus on what's going on in and around your community. How about the Image Awards? They'll be coming up on Fox on March 4th. And you will see some of the notable celebrities and maybe some of the unknown. And also on the other flip side of this here was a historian recognized for dedication to the city. And who are they talking about? None other but our own Steve Baker, town historian that knows quite a bit about the city of Monrovia. All right, Shelley at Savon in Arcadia. Wait till you hear what Michael Jordan had to say at the Image Awards. I know you're a Michael Jordan fan, Shelley at Savon in Arcadia. We fought over a picture of Michael Jordan, and you won because you worked at Savon. Okay. Why is it a crime to be overweight? There's an ad going on now with the fitness center. Something like an alien comes and it says, we'll get the fat ones first. How do you feel if you're overweight, slightly overweight? It makes you wonder, where are we going? No sensitivity no more? Did you know that Duarte has a new newspaper? Well, it's new to me. And they also have a new mayor, and that's Dr. Robert Davey. Maybe I'll get him to come on the show, and he can talk about what's going on new in Duarte. I always said that Monrovia should be a college town. You know, it has that atmosphere. Well, there's a new college in town, Mount Sierra. So if you've been waiting for a career change, but you wanted the college to come to you, well, you know what? It's at your doorstep. All right. What happens if you go for the championship twice and you don't win? Well, we know in the professional ranks, heads must roll. But you know what? That's filtered down to the high school, too, because if you don't win, where are we at? Let's get that. Don't worry, camera. I'm playing with you right there. We got it? All right, I'll hold still. Monrovia fires 6 football coaches. 6! That's a lot of folks looking for new employment. Maybe next year, gonna bring a championship? Well, wait till next season. We'll find out. Okay. You know, when you talk about the month of February, you talk about all kinds of things, from Valentine's candy to Black History Month to President's Day and Happy New Year's. But you know what? What about some of the dogs that's in the White House? No, I'm not talking about presidents. I'm talking about the friendly kind. Did you know that several presidents had pooches in the White House? We know about Bill Clinton and Buddy, but there's been a few others. There's a book out on, and it's called First Dogs, American Presidents and Their Best Friends by Roy Rowan and Brooks Janis. So check it out. That seems like LBJ with a mutt of a pooch. Okay. All right. 7 years later, a lot of times when you think of sports, you think of the hoopla of winning and all that greatness, but what happened when an injury happened? This player right here was injured during a game, I believe it was on Thanksgiving Day, Mike Utley. And I'll give a few cheers out for him for taking one big giant step in his road towards rehabilitation. Wishing him the most. I know there's a lot of folks out here from Detroit, those Lions, okay? Wishing him the most. All right. Over the weekend, I had the fun of going out to Lake Arrowhead. And I'm a newspaper fiend. I have to have my newspapers. So I picked up the Mountain News. And it was sort of ironic because someone had a very interesting story. February is not just for Valentine's. It's more than candy and roses. This particular reporter took the time to point out that Black History Month takes place in February, and we all should take the time to explore African Americans' contributions to the building of this country. Thought that was pretty good. Arrowhead. And then, on the other side of the fence, I look at the newspaper and it says, Inglewood High School cancels all the ethnic holidays. It seems as though that the Latino or Hispanic students feel as though 1 month focusing on African Americans' contributions in the building of America is a bit too much because they said they only had one day Cinco de Mayo. You know, I think the teachers should be doing a better job maybe explaining why this month takes place, okay? And there are books out there in Spanish. But you might say, well, he's not African American. But you know what? He'll show you the linkage of why he had the fortitude and the patience to deal with 27 years in prison. A lot of information that he survived on was information about the struggle of Black folks in America, believe it or not. All right, then what do I have? Okay, I thought this was pretty unique right here. This was on the bulletin board once on KGM. Can we focus in on it? Maybe you can see it. Some of the inventions created by African Americans. You won't find them in history books, at least not history books in the standard schools that we have now. That's why it's so important to focus on contributions that African Americans have made, because it builds up self-esteem, and it also builds up a better understanding of that we were more than just slaves in this country. All right. And you notice I say this country, and I also love this little caption right here. Because when you study African American history, when you study the contributions that we have made, you realize that it's American history. It is often the keystone in American history. It's the stone that the builder refused to recognize in many ways. All right, so you're probably wondering, all right, Ralph, you done took us around the world and you brought us back again. You do it so well at times. All right, what are we going to talk about tonight? And I want you, the viewers, to call in. I don't care how upset you may get, how bent out of shape you may get. Call on in. Come alive. Be an active participant. All right, I thought this was very interesting. A full-fledged shot on all the presidents that we have. Okay, that's pretty good. This was in the LA Times, February 15th. Hail to the Chiefs. You normally probably associate Chiefs with Indians. Or am I getting something mixed up? But anyway, from Washington all the way to Bill. We'll never forget Clinton, okay? It was pretty good. So if you can get that, teachers, get it. It's probably worth framing and having on the board and all that. But there's always one president that really stands out. Now, which one could it be? George Washington, founder of our country. What about Abe Lincoln that was at the crossroads of this young budding republic? Abraham Lincoln, that's who we're going to talk about tonight. All right? And my guest right here is Steve Recker. How you doing today?
Good. How you doing?
All right. Well, thank you for your patience. You know, I do my little in the news thing.
It was very interesting.
Okay.
Actually, it brought to mind, you were talking about dogs of the presidents.
Yes.
And there's an interesting story about Abraham Lincoln's dog. He had a dog named Fido.
Hold that story. Okay. Hold that story. All right, viewers. We're going to be talking about Abraham Lincoln tonight. And if you have any great presidential stories that you would like to share with us, don't hesitate to pick up the phone and say, I was at such and such when President such and such, or whatever. All right, now Steve is a historian on Mr. Abraham Lincoln. So first of all, let me ask you a question. How did you get out involved with this Lincoln fever, in a sense?
Well, I grew up in Pennsylvania, and when you're a child on the East Coast, most of your school trips are to battlefields.
Okay.
And I went to Gettysburg a number of times as a child. And of course, the Gettysburg Address was a seminal event tied in with Gettysburg.
Right.
And, you know, we'd also go to field trips to Washington, D.C.
All right. Now, your first take when you went to Gettysburg, what was your real first take? All right, we're coming here to this battlefield. Yeah. Don't look like nobody died there recently. Cannons around it. And what was your take?
Actually, when I was a child, I think my first take was probably, this is kind of interesting. The electric map was interesting, but other than that, I was probably, it probably went right over my head.
Okay.
And I didn't really understand it the first time, and it wasn't until later in my life that I went back a few times and started really appreciating what had happened.
Okay. All right. Now go on. I mean, you got off into Lincoln in a sense.
Yeah, and so what's really fascinating about the Gettysburg Address and Gettysburg to me is that it was Lincoln's way to not only reorient the struggle that the Civil War was about, he also did the same thing with the Emancipation Proclamation in sort of making it more of a noble cause instead of just trying to keep the Union together. But in a way, he also restated the Declaration of Independence in that he, in saying that all men are created equal, it was pretty much the first time, when the Declaration of Independence came out, it was pretty much all men are created equal, except whites are more equal. You know, okay. It didn't actually say that, but that was pretty much the way it was.
The one paragraph they didn't allow to have in.
Correct, about the slavery thing.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
And that was kept out. But in the Gettysburg Address, he was sort of restating that and saying that now, you know, it's a more inclusive document. And so there are a lot of parallels between the Declaration of Independence and the Gettysburg Address.
Now, it's funny you use that word inclusive, because we hear that from the Republican Party now are trying to be more inclusive with people of color.
Mm-hmm.
So are they sort of like going back to Lincoln in a sense?
Well, I mean, it's interesting that Lincoln was a Republican, but...
And most folks don't know that.
Yeah, most folks don't know that. And... But it's and you're not going to find that out, from Bill Clinton or talking about that, because he is the first president to talk about civil rights. We all know, just a little humor there. But I think that the interesting thing about that is that the Republican Party was actually much different back then, and it was in the 1930s that ideologically the Republican and the Democrat parties really sort of switched ideologies.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a very convoluted thing, but that's what's fascinated me about it, because when I first went to the battlefield, you know, I'd hear the Gettysburg Address and it would be interesting, and the monuments are very interesting, and Gettysburg does have a very incredible air about it.
Okay.
I mean, you're just taken by the ambiance of the battlefield.
Now, how many people died in that battle?
Well, there were 52,000 casualties.
Oh.
There were 52,000 casualties. That includes killed, wounded, and missing. That's quite a number.
So it's a heavy spirit there.
Yeah, I mean, there's a very heavy spirit there. That's more than the casualties in the Vietnam War. And it's very incredible. In fact, they estimate about 1,200 dead Confederates that are buried around the town that they don't even know where they are. Mm. In fact, a few years ago, they actually found a skeleton in the railroad cut, which is a very prominent part of the battlefield. And they dug it up and figured out that it was actually one of the soldiers that had fought there. But every once in a while, you know, some rain washes stuff
all
around,
right,
or,
right.
You know.
Now, recently in the newspaper, it was, they were going to take down a tower or something in Gettysburg.
Yeah, well, there's a big debate going on right now, because in order to maintain the battleground, they need money.
Right.
And they don't want to have a big commercial entity come in and take over the park, because then it's sort of like you're going to destroy it in order to save it.
Right, right.
So what the Park Service is trying to do is find a middle ground there where private institutions can come in and have certain facilities on the ground and near the ground, and you know, invest enough money in the battleground to keep it well maintained, but not to destroy the integrity.
Well, what's your take on that? Everything has to have a little money angle to it.
Right.
It has become like part amusement, but part history too.
Right. Well, that's the same thing. It's kind of like when Disney wanted to take over the Manassas battlefield,
yeah,
and they basically wanted to tear it down and have Civil War world.
Okay.
You know, so that you could come there on the battlefield and see a recreation of the battlefield. When actually, if you just walk around the fields, you you can experience something that you just can't experience anywhere else. And like I said, when I first went there as a child, the first thing that hit me was kind of like, I don't really understand this, but then, and it didn't seem as thrilling as, say, a big ride at Disneyland.
Yeah,
So maybe initially it wouldn't have jumped out at me. But then when you get a chance to spend some more time there and actually learn about the history and find out how interesting it is and how deep it is and how complex it is, and you realize how these men suffered and you realize how important the battlefield is, then you start to understand the value of having just the open ground as it was back then, so that you can get more of a feel of actually what happened, instead of sitting in a Disneyland diorama looking at pictures of what the battlefield is like underneath the diorama.
$25 ticket too.
Exactly.
It limits how many people can actually have that experience.
Absolutely. Whereas now anyone can just walk out on the battlefield and, you know, walk around and contemplate or have a picnic or, you know, whatever, mm-hmm. and it doesn't cost anything.
All right, I'll let you go back to the, we talked about presidents and their dogs, okay? And we know about Bill Clinton and Buddy. And tell us about Abraham Lincoln and his dog, Fido.
Fido, yes. He, a number of presidents have had dogs in the White House, and Lincoln broke the tradition of having very, you know, purebred fancy dogs in the White House. Thomas Jefferson's famous for his. I can't remember what kind of terrier they were, but you know, he had an interesting angle on it. Jefferson actually had some terriers of his own, but he didn't like dogs in general, and he felt that mutts were just, you know, dirty. In fact, he had all the dogs of his slaves killed, and it's, you know, it's a pretty chilling thing when you think about it. When
Wow.
he actually had, you know, his own dogs, but you know, it just shows, you know, his sensibilities were much different than ours.
Right, right.
And but Lincoln, of course, being a man of the people, he had this mutt called Fido that, you know, hung out in his office all the time and was just, you know, had full run of the place.
Just a common dog.
Just a common dog. And the interesting thing about his dog is that after Lincoln was assassinated, Fido went with the funeral train back to Springfield, where Lincoln was buried. And actually what happened was these hundreds of thousands of people came to Springfield. They wanted to see the dog because that was, you know, the closest living thing.
Yes.
And then so what happened was a few years later, the dog was hanging around the town, and this drunk beckoned the dog over and actually stabbed the dog to death, assassinated his dog.
What a way to go out.
Yeah, it's kind of strange.
And this person that did this insane thing, what was his story?
I don't really know. All that I know is that it was just a you know, a transient who, you know, beckoned the dog over and assassinated him. I don't know if there's any story about whether he had something against Lincoln or whether it was just, you know, it just kind of happened and it was a coincidence, you know, beyond that.
Interesting. All right, now what other interesting things can you share with us about Lincoln and why? Why the fascination with Lincoln? Do you, and also, do you think young people have any idea Lincoln, the man?
No, I think that in general, history books, as you were saying before, history books, in large way by design, just sort of run over events like the Civil War and Abraham Lincoln in a really fast way. They give you a little sound bite. Abraham Lincoln was an honest guy. He chopped logs, and that was about it. And so you don't really hear that much about how incredible the man was. And what has been interesting for me is getting in and reading the books and finding out that history isn't this simple little boring thing that happened in the past. It's just a few dates. When you start reading the stories about, like, say, slavery and how Lincoln dealt with that, how slavery went away throughout the course of the Civil War.
Well, some people say it hasn't gone away, but go ahead.
Exactly. Your point's well taken. But but still, you know, when you read about historically how he dealt with that issue, it's so much more interesting than just saying, well, he was against slavery, he was for slavery, he was ambivalent, whatever. You know, when you really get into the way that he dealt with, you know, bringing about the 13th Amendment, which abolished slavery, it's very interesting. And so what I found is that the more I read, even, you know, even if I read five books about Lincoln, I want to read that sixth because it starts filling in all these holes.
Okay, now what's myth and what's facts about Lincoln? The guy with the stovetop hat sitting at a desk with the oil light burning in a... What's true and what's not true?
Well, that's actually fact. I think that the hard part for people to get about Lincoln is that he almost seems like a caricature. I mean, everyone, you know, you hear about George Washington chopping down a cherry tree. Right. I cannot tell a lie. And it sounds like a little anecdote. And maybe it was sort of a political thing that he put out.
Yeah.
You take a guy like Abraham Lincoln, who was born on a farm. His father was killed by Indians. He taught himself how to read by lamplight and by firelight.
So that's fact.
That is fact. And he taught himself law. And he was actually, one of the very interesting things about him, growing up in Kentucky, he did make a living chopping wood. And he had an incredible set of arms. And he actually did row, one of his first jobs when he moved to Illinois was to row a barge down the Mississippi all the way down to New Orleans, which was actually his first contact with slavery. The Free saw a slave auction, and that's the first record they have of his comments about it, and he said he was sort of appalled by it. But the point was that he had all this physical strength, and when he would move around the small towns as he was growing up, he would, of course, run into all the local toughs, and people would hear how strong he is, and these guys would come and they'd
take
say,
"Take on Lincoln."
Yeah, take on Lincoln, but the truth is that he'd say, "Yeah, bring on your toughest guys," and he'd kick their butts. And he would, and that's actually a lot of the way that he got his original political stumpers, because the local toughs from the different towns would come to try to beat him, and he'd get into a fight with them, and he'd beat them, and they'd go, "Hey, Abe, you're all right. What can we do for you?" And they'd become his friends.
"I'll work for you."
Exactly, and that's how, and so he actually did have this incredible strength, and he was an amazing storyteller. He spent a lot of years on the circuit, going around as a circuit judge. In that time, most small towns wouldn't have judges, and so a number of lawyers would go around from town to town, and you know, and they'd be like troubadours. And they'd do their law thing, and then at night they'd sit around the tavern, and Abe Lincoln would spin yarns with the best of them. And so the truth of all his storytelling is really part of his genius, and that this carried through also when he was in the White House. Very often he would disarm people by, and frustrate them at the same time. He'd be in a cabinet meeting and they'd be talking about a very poignant issue, and he'd put his feet up on the table and he would say, "That reminds me of a story."
Okay.
And he would tell a story and everybody would be going, "Oh no, here comes another one of his stories." But then when he was done, people would, you know, get the idea of his story. And so in this way he was being jovial and getting everyone together and at the same time making very good points.
And making friends also.
Absolutely. I mean, one amazing thing about Lincoln is that he was a real coalition person. I mean, you talk about bipartisan. He is a real genius at that. And with the slavery issue, that was particularly important because when he was trying to get through the Civil War, he had a lot of people telling him that he had to make it more about a more moral issue like slavery than it, instead of just about bringing the Union together.
Economics.
Exactly. And so people like Horace Greeley would write these editorials saying, Abe, you've got to make it more, you know, about these issues. And so he would be able to bring these different factions together. He'd have the radical Republicans, the abolitionists saying, you have to just stop slavery now, forget all this step-at-a-time stuff. And then you'd have the radical Democrats saying, hey, you know, let's not rock the boat. Let's just, you know, bring the Union back together, leave slavery the way it is. You'd have the moderates saying, let's just make it so that when a new territory comes in, there's no slaves there. And what Abraham Lincoln realized was that that if he could keep the people that were already on his side, mm-hmm. and just build a larger coalition, then he would do that. In fact, in Frederick Douglass's biography, The Life and Times of Frederick Douglass, okay. Frederick Douglass talks a lot about how he was really amazed at how Abraham Lincoln was able to, you know, take things a step at a time, and he had this long view. And while some people were frustrated that the Emancipation Proclamation right. only freed slaves in the slave states, you know, it didn't free slaves in the northern states, Frederick Douglass realized that Lincoln had this long view. He realized that Lincoln knew that if he alienated the people that were already on his side, that he was just going to be trading new people for old people, and he wasn't really going to get anywhere.
All right, now what type of relationship did Abraham Lincoln have with Frederick Douglass?
A very fascinating one, actually. I mean, I was really surprised when I read that book. I mean, Frederick Douglass was a slave, and then he became, you know, a friend to Lincoln and a very prominent person, actually. And when you read his speeches in there, that's a lot of that book is his different speeches and his writings. I mean, you know, at the time, a lot of people had trouble believing that he was a slave because he was so eloquent.
Right, right.
Well, I mean, I read that, and I don't even think that. I just think, I can't believe anybody has this clear of a vision. And that's why I think, you know, especially here during Black History Month, I think that anybody, especially African-American children, if they were to read that book, they would be so inspired mm-hmm. at this brilliant man. And what Frederick Douglass did, he was actually a friend with John Brown.
Right.
And, you know, in the whole...
Now, John Brown wanted Frederick Douglass to side with him.
Right.
In a sense, in terms of violently overthrowing the government or engaging in physical violence to make changes happen.
Correct.
And Frederick Douglass takes the high road and say it only leads to death in many ways.
Exactly.
And all right, now, Bill Clinton and Vernon Jordan, same relationship, Abraham Lincoln and...
I don't quite think so.
Douglas?
Actually, it's, I think that, well, for one thing, Vernon Jordan was more of an insider.
Yeah.
And I don't think that, and Frederick Douglass was actually the first black man to be entertained at an inauguration reception, although he was almost thrown out by the police before he said, hey, I'm a friend of Abraham Lincoln's, just tell him Frederick's here. And Abraham Lincoln interceded at the last minute. He was also the first black to be entertained by the president in a business context. So, and actually it's an interesting story because he was there talking about a number of issues. He was talking about a recolonization of the blacks.
Yes.
And that was a big thing back then. They were talking about, I believe it was Liberia. You know,
yes.
The government was thinking about, you know, getting land in another country. And what I found inspirational about Frederick Douglass was that Abraham Lincoln said, you know, the Americans are against you. You know, you don't want to be here. Why don't you go back to this country?
Right.
And Frederick Douglass said, I'm an American.
Okay.
Said, this is where I belong.
Right.
And that's just such a beautiful thing to hear him say that. And it's so true. And so what the most interesting thing that
I can hear a viewer out there saying, all right, Ralph, you're not saying anything to, all right. Why is it beautiful for him to say that he's American and he's not reaping the benefits of being American?
Because I think that he was claiming ownership to being in America. Although he didn't have the full benefit of it at the time, he saw that if he could stay the course
mm-hmm.
and really stick it out, then in the long run, that blacks would have the same advantages as the whites. And so he said, look, you know, even though we don't have the full benefit of it now, we're not just going to give it up because it's our right,
right.
And so I'm going to stay the course. Which is, I mean, you talk about his relationship with Lincoln, it sort of turned on that exact thing. One of the most important meetings that he had with Lincoln was about the the creation of black regiments in the Union Army.
Yes.
As the war went on, Lincoln tried different military strategies. He tried, you know, first they were just going to keep the status quo,
yeah.
and then they wanted to take over a bunch of land. Then they figured they'd just kill as many people as they could. Finally, the fourth tact that the Lincoln administration was going to take was, we are going to make this about a moral cause, and we are going to try to get as many black slaves into the Union Army as we can, because then, you know, the Southerners won't be able to use them for labor,
right.
and the Northern Army will be able to use them, you know, in their regiments to fight. And when the 54th and 55th Massachusetts Regiments were created, and if you ever seen the movie Glory, that's
yes.
a really good movie
right.
about that. And when they were created, Frederick Douglass was very key to getting blacks excited about joining part of the army, because that was what they said. They said, why should we fight for the whites if they're treating us so poorly? And Frederick Douglass said, look, you've got to take the long view. If you get the rifle in your hand, then that's power.
Yes.
Okay, you've got to take it a step at a time. You've got to have the long view. But what was great about it was that the first, what Frederick Douglass told these people and what the administration told Frederick Douglass he could tell these people was that they'd get the same pay, they'd have the same uniforms, that, and one of the main issues was that Jefferson Davis was saying that if they caught black Union soldiers, mm-hmm. that they would make them slaves or kill them. And Frederick Douglass got the promise of the administration that that the Union Army would treat the black captured soldiers the same way that if a white Union soldier was captured.
Now, how much was that was true?
Well, that's the whole point. That's a really good point. What happened was, after the 54th and 55th Regiments went in, Frederick Douglass started seeing that these promises weren't really being kept.
Mm-hmm.
And so when he was asked to get regiments together for Pennsylvania, he said, I can't really do this in full conscience, because I can't go to these black people and say, go out and put your lives on the line for these people, you know, and fight, because they'll stand behind you when they haven't really been putting up there, where they've said they would. And so Frederick Douglass had a meeting with Abraham Lincoln about that very subject. And he said he went in and he made the four demands, and he said that he, you know, wanted to make sure that they got paid the same, that they were promoted the same, that they'd be treated the same, you know, if they were captured.
Now, didn't one guy, a black guy, get shot for refusing to participate in something because equal pay was not taking place?
I'm not really aware of that. I know that there were a number of black regiments that refused all pay.
All right.
For a while that they had.
All right, I'm going to find his name and give it to you before the show's
absolutely.
Over.
Absolutely, I'd be interested.
All right, let's take a different dimension of Abraham Lincoln. And if you'd like to call in and find out what's going on, don't hesitate to pick up the phone, 357-4974. I'm here with Steve Recker. He's a historian on Abraham Lincoln. And if you have some interesting questions, don't hesitate. Pick up the phone and join on in. Meanwhile, when you talk about every great man, man of vision, man in dire consequences, and Civil War was a dire consequences for the nation, the woman plays an integral role. Tell us something about Abraham Lincoln's wife.
Mary Todd Lincoln.
Yes.
Very interesting. She was actually from a slaveholding family. She was from Kentucky, like Lincoln was. And as a matter of fact, tying into what we were talking about, there's an interesting quote from Frederick Douglass talking about his attitude towards Mary Todd Lincoln, because a lot of people mm-hmm. said that they weren't sure that they could really trust her, because she was from a slaveholding family. She had two brothers that fought for the Confederacy. In fact, mm-hmm. one of her brothers was killed at Shiloh. That's pretty incredible when
yes,
you really think about it.
Yes.
And she did have one brother that fought for the Union. And Frederick Douglass actually said that he felt that it was an injustice to question her loyalty, mm-hmm. because the one thing that she remembers the most is after Abraham Lincoln had been assassinated, Mary Todd told one of her aides to get Abraham Lincoln's favorite walking stick. And he said, Fred Douglass will appreciate this the most, and sent that on to Frederick Douglass. And
Whoa.
He said that he really cherished that the most, and he thought that was a real clear signal from Mary Todd that, you know, that she supported you know, Abraham Lincoln in
So Lincoln was surrounded with a lot of pain and decisions. I mean, this is a lot of, when you think about it.
Oh, yeah.
Your president, the nation's divided. Your wife's family is Confederates. Mm-hmm. You're with the Union. He must have to, I mean, did he write anything personally about her? I always thought that at one time she was insane or something.
Well, after... they lost two children when they were in the White House.
Oh.
And actually, Jefferson Davis lost a child. His daughter fell off a balcony. And so that they both lost children in the White House. And after these deaths, Mary just really sort of went a little bonkers. She mm-hmm. just went, I hate to portray it as bonkers, but she secluded herself away and dressed in mourning clothes, you know, for a really long time. And there were conversations between her husband and herself saying that, Mary, you know, if you don't get yourself together and get out of this, we're going to have to institutionalize you. And she ultimately was able to pull herself out of it. But
let me ask you a quick question. We know the turmoil that's going on in Washington. We know how the, quote, media can really dog you.
Right.
How was the media back then with Lincoln and his wife? Was there any shots?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, the people that say, you know, that Bill Clinton gets the worst. I mean, when you read political cartoons back in that age, I mean, they were incredibly mean. They called him a baboon. I mean, they made all kinds of... When you look at the political cartoons, I mean, there's a great book called Lincoln in Caricature. It's a whole book of all these great woodcuts of Lincoln political cartoons of the time. And he's always made out to be this huge, lanky guy,
okay.
And he's just made fun of. And his wife, of course, they questioned her patriotism because of her family.
Yeah.
And he, you know, always really stuck by her, and he took that. And what was amazing about Abraham Lincoln was that he was always able to separate the man from the deed.
Hmm.
I mean, when, you know, if people would attack him, he would always be able to work with them. He was always able to separate the personal attacks from the fact that he had to work with these people and get stuff going. So even though there were incredible attacks on his wife and incredible attacks on him, you know, he was still able to keep it together.
All right, let's look at some of the paraphernalia, if I could use that term.
Sure.
We get the cameraman out here. We can focus on some things. Just tell the viewers that object there.
This is a very interesting photograph. It's a CDV, a carte de visite, that's actually a photograph of the time, and
okay, hold it there.
They would, this picture was actually taken February 9th, 1864, just a few months after Gettysburg, and you might recognize it because it's on the $5 bill.
Oh, okay.
And pictures like this were taken and used in a million different variations. They'd turn up, actually, interestingly enough, they turn up with different people's faces. They would take this and the Secretary of State would have a portrait, you know, using the same body but with his picture.
All right, you have another one. What else?
Yeah, but what's interesting about that is that it's not just on the $5 bill. This is a $1 bill from 1899 that has Abraham Lincoln and Ulysses S. Grant on it. And if you'll notice, it's the same picture over here of Abraham Lincoln. It's a very beautiful bill.
Now, when did they stop that and put George on the one?
Stop this and put George on the one. I believe it was right after this issue, around the turn of the century.
Oh, okay.
And, I really love these bills. And actually, these are large currencies. They used to have much larger bills.
This one is quite interesting.
Yeah, 50 this is...
50 cent as a paper currency. That's,
right.
That's truly special.
Yeah, this is I believe, the issue of 1863. March 3rd, 1863, Abraham Lincoln. And this has... this is interesting because right around the time of the Civil War was when greenbacks came in, the northern currency.
Okay.
And at the time, there were a lot of people that weren't, you know, they were very suspicious and wouldn't accept them, so they were just coming in. But the problem was when the war came about, they needed all the metal that they could for arms.
Right.
And so that they couldn't have change floating around, so they came up with this fractional currency. And so you get a lot of fractional notes like that.
Now, what is this here? That's pretty
This is
unique.
The first day of issue of a Lincoln stamp. It actually has the, let's see if I can get a good angle there. It's got the Gettysburg Address on it. First date of issue, 1948 of this particular stamp. And it's just a little collectible that I
now,
got.
Now, I have wanted to ask you before the show, who gives the best rendition of the Gettysburg Address, in your opinion?
Well, actually, the other day I saw Charlton Heston do it.
Oh, Moses, huh?
Yeah,
the white Moses, I should say.
And I thought that he did a really good job. I don't think that he was very accurate to how Lincoln did it. Supposedly, Lincoln had a very high tenor voice, sort of squeaky, but it did project really well.
All right, Lincoln is also found on stamps. Let's share those.
Okay. This is a whole bunch of stamps. And the fun thing about this is, I mean, this I got this at the Ford's Theater, and it's really only a couple dollars. So if you're looking to get into collecting this sort of stuff, if you have interest, you know, it's not really expensive to get into it. You can really have some fun and get to know
now, is that
these people.
Lincoln, or is that any president?
As far as the different stamps?
Yeah. All paraphernalia.
Yeah, I think that Lincoln stuff is more valuable because it's more collectible and more people are interested, but at the same time, there's more of it. So very often, you know, that will decrease the value. If you tried to get a picture of a more obscure president, you know, there'd be, it'd be a little more difficult and maybe more costly. But of course, the Lincoln signatures, stuff like that's going to be really expensive.
Do you have that, the Lincoln
signature? I don't have an actual Lincoln signature, no.
Does anybody out there in Monrovia have a Lincoln signature?
Yeah, send it on in. Come on,
make a gift to the cause. Tell us something about this book here.
This book is very interesting. It's called A Picture Story of Lincoln's Life, and this has 600 pictures in it. One of the most interesting part of this book is that it has, in the back, it has every picture, every carte de visite actually taken of Lincoln, and it shows all the different pictures, and it's very easy to get an idea of how he aged. Throughout time, and to see all the different pictures.
So the when they talk about the White House will age you.
Oh, absolutely.
You can look at Lincoln and you can really tell.
Yeah, if you look at the picture from 1861 to 1865, it's a remarkable difference. There's actually a picture here that's sort of interesting. I mean, there's a lot of pictures of him.
All right, now let me ask you. He was a president that decided to grow a beard. Was any take on that?
Actually, it was a young girl that wrote him a letter saying that he had a kind of a weak chin, and she thought that he'd look more presidential. Just some young girl saying that, not trying to be rude or anything, but just sort of gave him that idea so that when he went to the White House, he grew that. So that's actually...
He took that advice.
He took that advice, the little girl, exactly.
That tells a lot about him, too. I mean, for someone to take the advice of a child to heart and say, let me try it.
Right.
And he tried it, and he stayed with it.
Right. And it's interesting because you always... You know, he was a politician. He was a wise politician, no doubt about it. I mean, you know, the people that took him as a yokel every time were blown right over by him because he was very, very smart. But at the same time, he did have a lot of goodness in him. And there's a lot of discussion about, you know, now that everyone's getting cynical about elected officials and all that, it's kind of hard to believe that there could be someone with standards that actually, you know, followed his heart. And it's an interesting thing to try to decide how much of what he did was just electioneering. Like there are stories about he had an aide follow him around and write down the names of people so that when he saw them again, he would be able to say, oh, Mrs. Jones, how are you? How are the kids? But at the same time, he did show genuine interest. And there are a lot of anecdotes about people that he knew that, you know, did favors for him when he was young that came to the White House and he did remember them and brought them in and paid a lot of attention to them, and they were always very stunned. Oh my goodness, I knew Abe when he was 9, and here I go to the White House and he remembered me and he brought me in. So it's interesting to try to figure out, you know, what's going on. But the fun thing is that he's just a very complex person, and to try to think that you're going to really get a full picture of what he's like, you're not going to do it.
It's sort of like a puzzle still missing a piece.
Right.
So even up to this point right now, you still don't think you know Mr. Lincoln?
Oh, not at all. Not at all. I'm still learning all the time. I have great respect for the man, and I do believe that, in general, I really trust what he was doing, and I trust his intentions, and I'm really proud of what he has done, being both an American and, a Republican. But he... But at the same time, you know, you always want to keep your mind open, you know, because, you know, just to look for other complexities because, you know, he was a person like anyone else and he had his foibles.
All right. Now, his wife had two miscarriages or didn't give birth to two children in the White House. how did they fill that void? What is there anything written that talked about their relationship when they took a break from this big dilemma that was hanging over their head?
Well, they really didn't really get much of a break. He was pretty much consumed. Actually, he spent most of his time in the War Office, telegraph office, and he rarely left Washington. He left. He went to Gettysburg, and he went to visit the Army of the Potomac, I believe about 14 times. Mm. But other than that, he pretty much stayed in Washington, and Martha pretty much stayed pretty close to home. But, you know, the children were his big diversion. Mm-hmm. You know, he did have children that lived through the whole time, and they, ran loose all the time through cabinet meetings, pretty much anything.
How many other children did he have?
I believe he had two other children.
Okay.
And Robert lived to be the oldest.
How old did he live to be?
I'm not really sure. I believe he actually lived into the 20th century.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And
now, that's something they don't talk about in history books, the children of Lincoln.
No, not really a lot. I mean, they stayed pretty low-key. And
out of fear? Out of necessity?
Maybe. I mean, you can imagine there were, those were difficult times, and he was assassinated. Right. And, the feelings were very strong. And after the, after the Civil War, there was still a lot of animosity going around.
Right.
In fact, one of the great ironies that I believe is about someone doing something they think is right and actually hurting their cause was John Wilkes Booth.
Yes.
I mean,
yes.
John Wilkes Booth assassinating Abraham Lincoln was the worst thing that could have happened for the South. Because during Reconstruction, Abraham Lincoln, actually, all the way back in 1863, he was talking about his plans for Reconstruction.
Right.
He was talking about how he would bring the loyal people of the South back in, and how they'd give the farms back to the people in the South after the war. But when Abraham Lincoln was killed, there was nobody to counteract this vengeance that the Congress felt.
And
when Andrew Johnson came in, I mean, it was pretty much, the Southerners were just in really bad straits.
Now, were there any other assassination attempts on his life prior to Wilkes Booth?
Well, there was actually, when he was coming to Washington in the very beginning, I mean, mm-hmm. you talk about people giving him grief politically, there was supposedly an assassination plot in Baltimore. Baltimore was in Maryland, which was a border state, mm-hmm. and it wasn't very sympathetic to the North, and you had to, of course, go through Baltimore to get to Washington,
right.
D.C. And Lincoln went through Albany and Philadelphia and Trenton, all these places on the way to Washington, D.C., and he went through Baltimore, but what happened was that he had heard about this assassination plot, and he got it from what he considered very reliable sources. And so when he went through Baltimore, he actually went through under cover of night. He was going to come in and make a speech during the day. And he also had on this hat and this shawl that somebody gave him. And I can't remember the exact story about why he had that on instead of his typical stovetop hat. But when he got to Washington, D.C., everybody said, oh, Abe's a chicken. He dresses in girls' clothes to get away from this assassination thing. So he came in severely crippled as far as, him coming in a position of strength. Because
mm-hmm.
the whole time before his inauguration, he kept saying, look, I'm not going to talk about my plans. I'm not going to talk about my position. I'm going to go into office and do my best. And so he was really, he wasn't really defending himself or putting out his position, so he was kind of vulnerable.
Sort of, which is sort of now the trend now.
Oh, it's very much the trend.
You know,
right.
Now they don't tell you what they're going to do.
Right, they're in office.
It's like, just elect me, and
right.
I'll take care of the problem.
Exactly.
Center stage is sort of
right.
the field. What's the story behind the stovetop hat?
Oh, well, that's just... it was just the dress of the day. I mean,
that was style of the day.
Yeah, and actually, that was his office. He kept his papers up there. He kept his hat. And
that's interesting,
yeah.
huh?
In fact,
notes and anything.
Absolutely. And he would he'd go around. That's where he'd keep his stuff. And he'd get someplace and just pull all the stuff out. And in fact, the Huntington Library here in San Marino had a Lincoln exhibit about a year ago, and it had the hat that he wore when he was assassinated. And an interesting anecdote about that, about how that was his moving office.
Interesting. Now,
yeah.
All right, now, did he become obsessed with those type of hats? Did he own, how some people have a trademark, and once they have that trademark, it's like they have a closet full of them. Or was it just three or four hats that maybe he had?
Yeah, I think he was pretty low-key about it. he did dress really well, and he was very conscientious about that because he really had respect for his office. And also in the time, I mean, men wearing suits all the time and women dressing up. I mean, it was pretty standard fare of the time. So when you see all the pictures, he's got the beautiful outfit on, the beautiful hand-sewn outfits all the time. That was pretty standard. But I think that was more just his way of respecting the office. I mean, he was, you know, from a very humble beginnings.
Right, right.
So he wasn't a clothes horse. I mean, he didn't go around thinking he was this Jim Dandy at all.
Yeah.
In fact, he was a real lanky guy. In fact, there's a great quote by Frederick Douglass when he's talking about his first meeting with Lincoln. He said that he went into the office and he started to explain who he was, and Abraham Lincoln, he put him at ease and said, "No, the Secretary of State's told me all about you." And how Frederick Douglass describes Lincoln getting up was, he said he drew in his feet from all over the room.
a sprawling giant.
Yeah, he just sort of brought him in, and it's a great image of just, you know, he brought his feet in from all the corners of the room, and he actually sat very often, because he did have really long legs, you know, he sat sideways a lot with his legs over the side of the chair, or with his hands around his legs, with his knees up in his chin. And
you think he was self-conscious about his height?
I don't really think so. I don't think he was self-conscious in general at all. I think he was pretty comfortable with himself. Okay. He was a very, very strong man, but I think he was very humble.
Yes.
And but he, I don't think that he felt insecure about
that. Now, how was he viewed in the South?
Which part of the South?
Is he the villain in Atlanta? Let's go to.
Yeah, I think that if you're in the South in a high school. Maybe not so much nowadays, but easily through the 60s and 70s, you'd be much more likely to see Stonewall Jackson or Robert E. Lee than you would Lincoln and Washington. But the interesting thing, you talk about the South's view of presidents. George Washington is actually on a lot of Confederate currency, and the South saw themselves as the heirs to George Washington's legacy. Because when you really think about it, the people that brought about the Revolution were Virginians.
Yes.
And, you know, Thomas Jefferson, George
Henry,
Washington.
Yeah.
Exactly. And so the Southerners saw their legacy more, you know, coming out of people like George Washington. So you will see a lot of, you know, commemorative statues and posters about George Washington, much more so than you'll see Lincoln. I mean, there's not, I think that's changing some, but I think in general, they're, so to speak, there are still
the mindset is still locked in
to
a different period
I think so.
Of time. Do you think when you focus on the photographs of Lincoln, was he spiritual? Did he believe? Did he have a particular religion? I mean, what role did religion play with him?
Well, he was
in his life.
Yeah, he didn't. He wasn't all that overtly religious, but you know, God did play a big part in his documents, in his statements, and he did believe very strongly, as the Founding Fathers did, that the Union is basically going to work based on a Judeo-Christian ethic. So that if you don't have this moral underpinning, then none of this stuff really matters.
Mm-hmm.
And so, in that sense, he was very spiritual. He also had a dream about his death. He saw himself in a coffin. Actually, there's a picture in here of him on his deathbed in his coffin that someone took. There's actually a picture of him lying in state.
Hmm. And he had this vision beforehand?
He had this vision before. He had a dream that he went into one of the rooms in the White House, and there was someone lying in state, and he asked who that was, and he said, "Oh, that's the president." And this was very soon.
So you think he knew he's not going to outlive this term, as they say? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I think he had a feeling that he was going to be assassinated. He didn't really have a great fear of it. In fact, you asked about assassination attempts. There were a number of times that he'd go walking alone, he'd go riding alone, and his bodyguards would always be very upset about this, but he really wanted to be accessible to the people. And in fact, Frederick Douglass talks about this slight premonition he had about Lincoln being assassinated. He went up to him right before he was killed just had a chance to see him and spoke to him briefly and just, you know, had a feeling that was going to happen.
Hmm.
Yeah.
All right, now a lot of people talk about the ghost of the White House. and Lincoln in particular seems to...
The Lincoln bedroom.
Yeah, the Lincoln bedroom. If you got money, you can sleep in it, but that's another chapter. What does history say about the Lincoln bedroom?
Well, it actually wasn't... he actually didn't sleep there. It was a room that he used as an office. A lot. He had meetings in there. So as far as, you know, any kind of apparition, I don't think that there's a lot of stock in that. There is a lot of Gettysburg, though.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of anecdotes about spirits there, and you know, Lincoln said that he actually made comments about that there, and it was actually there were some quotes from his times at Gettysburg that surprised a lot of people when he spoke about how it struck him spiritually to be there on the ground before he gave the Gettysburg Address. He took a tour of the battlefield, and he spoke about, you know, how he felt about it spiritually, and that was one of the rare clues into how he felt about religion.
So that's so. What religion was he brought up in? Pennsylvania. What's the dominant religion at that period of time?
I don't know. I would guess Episcopal.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. Does any particular teacher stand out in his mind?
Yeah, there was a. He had a number of different people that. And of course, his name escapes me right now. But he had a, it was actually a local merchant that would loan him books, and actually, what was interesting about a lot of his letters was that lawyers that he worked with and local merchants and that would rewrite his letters with him and go through that stuff. So he had a lot of people that that would give him books, and he would memorize them, go over them, and you know. So right. he had a lot of mentors.
The minute mark is upon us, believe it or not. Now, if there's a book that you would like to share with viewers out there, those that would like to know something about Abe Lincoln, do you have that?
Yeah, I think that there's actually this is one of the volumes of Carl Sandburg. It's a 6-volume set. There's actually 2 volumes called The Prairie Years.
Okay, let's open it up and get the little gentle book there. Is this available and still in print?
Yes, actually, it's by Carl Sandburg, and it's 6 volumes. You can get all 6 volumes, but if you want, there's a single volume that, you know, the compendium of the whole thing. That's, but this is more of an old style. David Herbert Donald wrote a book called Lincoln that came out, you know, in the 90s. It's actually...
All right, that's the end of the show. Believe it or not, there's a store to open up in Monrovia called The Attic. I'm pretty sure if you want to check out some unusual paraphernalia, check it out. Thank you.